Welcome today. We've got Matt Turner here that we're going to be speaking with. Matt's with the Native Plant Society of Texas. Mm-hmm. And you've written two books here that we have, The Remarkable Plants of Texas,
yeah.
Of which there are many.
Yes.
And then, of course, you have a new book out now that's The Unnatural Texas, about invasive species.
Yes.
And you wrote this with Robin Doughty?
Doughty, yes.
Doughty, okay.
Professor Emeritus in Geography here at UT, yeah.
What's an invasive species?
So an invasive species has to be two things. One, it has to be non-native, which means a human had to have brought it in.
Okay.
So it cannot have existed naturally or historically in a given ecosystem.
Okay.
And then secondly, it has to cause some kind of harm, the major ones being to the environment or to human health or to the economy.
Okay, and what about ecosystem health? Is there a...
Yeah, well, I think that's the one that's the hardest to quantify,
right.
And gets the least attention.
It's not
attention.
In the official definition.
Okay, yeah.
As an example, some that people that might really be familiar with are house sparrows and European starlings.
Yeah, I don't know how many people are familiar with that, but those are not native birds. They were brought in intentionally. Partly, sparrows were at the very beginning in the 1850s, because the native bird life in the U.S. cities, especially industrializing cities, mm-hmm. were vanishing. They didn't like all the noise and
sure.
hubbub.
Sure.
And so the cities were rather kind of devoid of bird life, and there were these inchworms that the birds were not eating. And so there was this bright idea, let's bring in sparrows. We all love sparrows. Let's bring them in. They'll eat the inchworms. Everyone will be happy.
Huh.
Plus, there was this notion that we're British, we're English, and we like Shakespeare, and Shakespeare mentions all these birds, so let's bring in all the birds mentioned in Shakespeare. It's hard to imagine that now, but that was a very common idea. So both sparrows and starlings were brought over partly just because we were culturally familiar with them and we wanted them around us.
Yeah. So what we happens? Brought them over, but what happened?
You know, so they don't eat the inchworms, and they proliferated too much, and they started taking over. Well, for a while, we loved them,
right.
And we protected them. And in fact, Texas made it a law not to destroy a sparrow.
Huh.
It was added to the penal code. But then they went crazy, and there was just too many of them, and they were fornicating and making too much noise in the streets, and people didn't like this. They were became to be called British bulliers. And so there became this sort of sparrow war between those who love the sparrows and wanted them here and those who would just as soon make a sparrow pie out of them. They were making pies out of them in New York. So there was this big controversy. And so basically more and more people began to see for the first time that maybe we shouldn't be bringing things all around the world to different countries without thinking about it. There are repercussions.
Sure.
And that's what eventually gave rise to the Lacey Act of 1900, where for the first time, four different species were, like, including starlings and sparrows, were to be forbidden to be brought in and to be transported between states. That list has subsequently been amended many times and includes hundreds of animals now. So the Lacey Act of 1900 was kind of a sea change when people realized, wait a minute, maybe people shouldn't bring everything, everywhere, all the time. Because the attitude before was, it's very anthropocentric. Humans are in
right.
charge, and we can bring whatever we want, wherever we want.
Sure.
New Zealand should look like England.
Right.
America should look like England.
Right.
So let's make it look more like that, because we were familiar with it.
Well, I was reading a little bit about this to prepare, too, and I noted that, you know, the starlings have an impact ecologically as well. They actually... harm, they're nest robbers, and they'll actually kill bluebird babies and pull them out of the neck,
right.
The nest, and then take that nest for their own. And
right, both those species take purple martins out of their nest, and so
okay.
purple martin defenders are really big about keeping them out of the nest. Yeah, they're big bulliers, they have big beaks, and they kind of just bully other birds and take over. Starlings take grain off the fields, and they cause some airplane accidents as well, because they flock in these enormous flocks.
What's the dilemma or the challenge here, so to speak,
in
that you're addressing with your title?
So a dilemma is you have to choose between two unacceptable alternatives or undesirable alternatives.
Okay.
So there's actually several here, but one is, as humans, we're bringing things all over the planet all the time. And the pace of that is getting faster and faster, and there's nothing we can do to really stop it. But the repercussions, some of these are going to take off, And so how do we control and manage these things that we are unavoidable to bring in? And then the choices we make on how to manage them, each one of them has strong negatives. You know, do you poison it and then maybe poison the environment? Do you burn
sure.
it?
Sure.
There's problems with burning. Or do you bring in another animal, a biocontrol, another
right.
animal to devour the thing that you brought in? But then that has to be a non-native creature as well,
right.
specifically designed to go after that. There's all sorts of examples from history of those going awry as well.
Sure.
So you have this sort of intractable problem that doesn't have easy solutions.
Right.
So that's sort of the heart of the dilemma.
To play devil's advocate here,
yeah.
there's a lot of people or that take the camp, and there's an author, Emma Maris, who wrote a book, Rambunctious Garden, who says, nature's everywhere, but the one thing that's consistent where it is that it's not, is it's not pristine. We've already messed it up. So at this point in time, Why are we concerned so much about invasives?
Right. Well, that's kind of that's sort of a complete defeatist position. I think the answer is always more nuanced and somewhere in between. So part of it is true invasives do a lot of damage. They take over huge areas. Think of kudzu vine.
Right.
They cause a lot of problems. So turning a blind eye to those problems seems silly for multiple accounts. Also, I think people want their places to look like their places. I mean, that's been a recent trend. Texans
sure.
want Texas to look like Texas
Absolutely.
And not like New England.
Absolutely.
And not like Brazil and not like Asia.
Right. We are part of nature and we are part of that system. If that system isn't thriving, that translates into us really not thriving as well.
Yes, that's true.
Let's go over a few of these species that I think you cover in the book. One of them is the Chinese tallow tree.
Right, the Chinese tells you it's from China. But yes, it was brought in by none other than Benjamin Franklin, who was on the lookout for plants that would help the colonies.
Right.
And the fruits of Chinese tallow, or tallow, it's very waxy. The outer surface has a saturated fat that can be used like in candles,
mm-hmm.
and that the inside, the kernel, is a linseed type oil, an unsaturated fatty acid.
Okay.
That's way more critical because it's used in biodiesel. So
it is
still to this day one of the world's most oil productive trees, richest in oils of all trees. So he was not stupid in bringing it in.
Right.
And in fact, he didn't cause really the invasion. It just took off a little bit on the South Carolina coast. But then U.S. government officials were spreading it all over, and a lot of other people too, were trying to constantly make a viable industry out of this.
Right.
And to this day, 200 years later, we still haven't got one.
So
that's the problem. You bring something in, it looks good on paper. In
right.
China, it was working. And then for a number of reasons too hard to go into here, it doesn't
right.
quite work here. In the meantime, you have an invasion, and now it's everywhere.
Okay. Another one that's going to have a huge impact coming to pretty much all the U.S. is emerald ash borer.
A beautiful little jewel beetle. We've known it's coming. It was brought in through packing crates into Michigan in like 2006 or 8. It was hidden in trees. No one noticed it until already 1,000 trees were dying. By then, it was already spreading throughout the Midwest. And so Texans have been knowing it's coming, and we've been waiting for it to come. And it goes after ash trees. And there's
right.
about 8 species of ash in Texas.
Right.
And unfortunately, there's really no solution. We're probably going to lose most of our ash trees in Texas. They were waiting for it in East Texas, and then suddenly it appeared in Fort Worth on a 10-year-old's iNaturalist application. So that's a little plug for iNaturalist. Anyone can put that on their phone and go start taking pictures, and experts will come in and identify things that are on there.
Well, that's a great segue, because
yeah.
I'm sure everybody's interested in this. What can we do?
Be alert, be vigilant, try to realize when new things start springing up everywhere, ask what they are, find out what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Try not to plant too many non-natives in your yard, or at least ones that you know are going to stay put. Talk to your nurseries and HOAs about why they're selling things that are arguably dangerous, like Nandina and ligustrum,
yeah.
even though they're technically not invasive by state standards, they're right. acting invasive. Just be aware that as a human, you're a vector all the time. You're bringing stuff in. So don't dump your aquarium in any lake. Don't let your cats roam out at night. Wipe your shoes when you go from one hiking spot to another.
Mm.
Something like 80% of non-native plants in Enchanted Rock have to ride along the trails. Why? Because that's where people have been walking somewhere else and brought them in. Empty your boat and clean it really well before you go between lakes. You know, the zebra mussels are everywhere now.
Right.
So pay attention to what you're bringing in to your garden, in your life, in your yard, and what you're carrying around with you.
Well, Matt, thank you so much for speaking with us today. Okay. This is a very complex issue, and I think you addressed quite well. Can't wait to read the book. Thank you for coming with us today.
Thanks for inviting me.
And next, Daphne will be up to answer all your questions.